ओके सर, मेरे को स्टार्ट है।
यस यस
अनुश्री। ओके लाइफ डजंट गिव यू व्हाट यू वांट, इट गिव यू व्हाट यू नीड टू डू टू ग्रो टू एक्सपेंड। With this note, I would like to invite Glejanus to the stage for my presentation.
Pardon?
Microphone.
Or okay.
Okay, mic can let him mute you. Okay, fine. Life doesn't give you what you want. It gives you what you need to develop, to grow, to expand. With this note, I would like to give my heartiest welcome to your resource person, principal, teachers, and my dear friends. We, the Department of Statistics, St. Thomas College, Autonomous Thrissur, blissfully invite one and all here for the webinar on statistical computing using SPSS. Now, let us begin the webinar by invoking the presence of God Almighty. I invite Namita Jose, student of final year MSc Statistics.
സത്യമായി ശുദ്ധ സ്നേഹമായി ദിവ്യ ജ്ഞാനമായി വാഴും ദൈവമേ, നിത്യവും നിൻ കൃപാകടാക്ഷങ്ങൾ ഏകനേ ഞങ്ങൾക്കിപ്പോഴും. പാരിലാലംബഹീനരായോരെ സേവിപ്പാൻ ശക്തി നൽകണം. സത്യധർമാദി സൽഗുണങ്ങളാൽ ജീവിതം ധന്യമാക്കണം. സത്യമായി ശുദ്ധ സ്നേഹമായി ദിവ്യ ജ്ഞാനമായി വാഴും ദൈവമേ, നിത്യവും നിൻ കൃപാകടാക്ഷങ്ങൾ ഏകനേ ഞങ്ങൾക്കിപ്പോഴും.
Thank you, Namita, for the soothing prayer. To welcome is to show the honor. To welcome is to show the integrity. I invite Ms. Ashley Matthew, PM, Assistant Professor of Department of Statistics, to welcome the gathering.
Respected dignitaries, dear teachers, and my dear students, we are in a world where every decision depends on data and various methods of analyzing it. Data analysis has become a necessity. With this revelation, we, the Department of Statistics, St. Thomas College, Thrissur, is organizing a webinar on statistical computing using SPSS to enhance the computational abilities of the statistics aspirants. I extend a warm welcome to Dr. William Chakur, Head Department of Statistics and Dean of Research, St. Thomas College, Thrissur. This webinar is a fruit of his constant encouragement and guidance right from the beginning. Welcome, sir. I would like to welcome Reverend Father Martin K.A., our principal, who's here to inaugurate this event in spite of his busy schedule. hearty welcome, Father. An enthusiastic and cordial welcome to our invited speaker, Dr. Gleeja Veer, Assistant Professor, Department of Statistics, College of Veterinary and Animal Sciences, Thrissur. Hearty welcome, ma'am. We have been fortunate enough to be backed by a team of dedicated colleagues, research scholars and students. I'm really glad to welcome all my colleagues, students and teachers and all the participants of this webinar. Welcoming you all once again to this program. Winding up, thank you one and all.
Thank you, Ashley, miss. Next, I would like to invite Dr. V.M. Sacco, the head of the Department of Statistics and the Dean of Research of St. Thomas College, Autonomous Thrissur, for the presidential address.
Okay. Dear Principal Dr. Martin K. and dear resource person of today's session, Dr. Gleeja Veer, dear faculty members, researchers, and students from various institutions. As we know, the Department of Statistics is conducting a webinar on statistical computing using SPSS. You know, SPSS is a well-known popular software to do various statistical analysis in various fields. So while doing a project or preparing a PhD thesis report, everywhere we need the statistical tools. So moreover, the Department of Statistics, St. Thomas College possesses the license of the statistical software SPSS. So I feel this demonstrative seminar will be helpful for all the researchers and students who are assembled through online platform here. As we know, Dr. Gleeja, Assistant Professor in Department of Statistics, Veterinary College of Mannuthy, is an expert in SPSS. She has consented to give a talk on SPSS for our students and various students from various institutes. And our principal, Dr. Martin K., he's giving all type of support to conduct this type of seminars. And he will inaugurate today's webinar after my talk. So let this event become a driving force to your analysis of various research and project activities. So wish you all the best. Thank you.
Thank you, Chaku sir. Now let us move on to the inaugural session. I invite Reverend Father Martin K.A., our principal, to inaugurate the webinar.
Good afternoon, one and all. Dr. Gleeja Veer, Assistant Professor, Department of Statistics, College of Veterinary and Animal Sciences, Mannuthy, resource person of the day. Dr. V.M. Sacco, the HOD of Statistics Department, as well as the Dean of Research, Ms. Ashlyn Matthew, the coordinator. Dear faculty members, dear students, and dear friends, as you know, the data is becoming all the more important day by day. Data analysis is also is becoming more important. Data is also very precious these days because you know, to get the data of any data is very costly, very precious, and there are also plenty of controversies regarding data analysis and all. So here we have a webinar being inaugurated today on statistical computing using SPSS, and Dr. Gleeja Veer is an expert in this field. I'm very happy that even though we are going through the time of pandemic as well as very heavy rains, still the Department of Statistics is interested in the field of academics. And I take this opportunity to congratulate Dr. E.M. Sacco and Professor Ashlyn Matthew, as well as the entire team, in organizing such fruitful ventures in spite of the pandemic situation as well as of the floods situation. So, with these words, you know, anyway, necessity is the mother of invention. So, the circumstances which make us to progress, you know, the humanity has always progressed under pressure. The world war, First World War, Second World War, and great calamities have made or opened the great possibilities to the future. So we also make this opportunity, this obstacle to an opportunity, and we are conducting this webinar, and that's the true human spirit to move forward, to go ahead. So with these words, I declare this webinar being inaugurated. Have a great session ahead. Thank you. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Father. The world is full of diamonds and gems, and we are having some of them here today to build this event. With this note, I would like to invite Dr. Glija VL, Assistant Professor of Department of Statistics, College of Veterinary and Animal Science, Mannuthy, for the presentation. Over to you, ma'am.
Thank you. First of all, let me thank all the organizers of this program, St. Thomas College, Chaku sir, and the principal of St. Thomas College, and everyone gathered over here for being here for the talk. Okay, and a special thanks to St. Thomas College for inviting me to share the knowledge I have on this SPSS and statistics with you. Okay, so let me start the presentation. So most of you know SPSS. You might have used SPSS for some of the analysis. And anyway, you might be knowing different principles and methods in statistics. With that assumption, I'm progressing with this talk. So the topic is, or the contents of the talk is divided as introduction to SPSS, then descriptive statistics, parametric test, non-parametric test, correlation and regression. So first of all, let us know what is meant by SPSS. It is a short form for statistical package for the social sciences. It has been started like that. But later, apart from social sciences, it has included almost all the fields of sciences. So now it has been known as statistical product and service solutions. So now you have many versions of SPSS. SPSS 28 is available now. Okay, up to 20, SPSS 28. It has reached to that much versions. And now you can see it comes as IBM SPSS. But this SPSS is a commercial software. It is not an open source software. So we have to purchase in order to work in it. But it is very simple to work with it because it is a menu-driven program. Other softwares such as R, Python, etc., when we are using for analysis, it is not menu-driven. You have to write some program commands. Okay, but SPSS, on a click, everything is available. That's why it has become very popular. Now, when you want to open SPSS, you have to go to the start, then you have to specify the whichever the version you have to click on it. Like that, you can open SPSS, or otherwise, if you have a data file of SPSS in your computer, double clicking on that will open your SPSS, or you can click.
Madam, please share your screen.
Sorry. Yes, sorry, Doc. I thought that it was my mistake. Okay, is it visible? I think, isn't it?
Yes, ma'am.
Yes, yes.
And I am audible also, isn't it?
Yes. You're audible.
Okay. So we were starting with statistical computing using SPSS. So The talk is organized like this. First, we will have an introduction to SPSS, and then we will see how to do analysis for descriptive statistics and parametric test, non-parametric test, and correlation and regression. Then we have already introduced what is the expansion of SPSS. It was known as statistical package for the social sciences, and now it stands for statistical product and service solutions. And all the story I have shared, I hope you remember. Okay, so it is a menu driven problem. So whenever you want to open SPSS, you have to go to start. You have to just click, there will be, if you have installed SPSS in your computer, you can click IBM. Here I have installed 24, IBM SPSS 24. So I have to click IBM SPSS Statistics 24 for opening it. So nowadays SPSS 28 is available. Okay. So this also I have told, you just click on, if you have an SPSS data file in your desktop, you have just click on it, it will get opened, or you can double click on the icon of SPSS. If you have installed your SPSS in your desktop, you just click, double click on that, you will get it opened. Okay. Now, so let us see how it is getting opened in my computer. So here, if I double click on it, it will get opened, and I will be receiving a window like this. Okay, this window will be appearing. So here you can see that it has been written as a data editor. So there are many windows in SPSS. If I click file, new, it sees data, syntax, output, script. You can see over there, here, isn't it? So there are four windows in SPSS that we were saying as, there is a data editor, output viewer, syntax editor, and script window. So what is the data editor window? It is the place where you can enter the data. The data editor window comes with data view and variable view. In data view, you enter the data, and the details of variables will be displayed in variable view window. Okay, variable view, which is a part of data editor window. And whenever you save a file, a data file, you will have the extension as .sav. Now, whenever you do some analysis, the results of those analysis gets opened in an output viewer window. Okay, so there is another window which is known as output viewer. It displays output and also the errors. And when you want to save that output file, it will have the extension as .spv. Now, whenever you do analysis, the syntax of that analysis being shown. So you can copy the syntax into syntax editor window, and you can make changes, and you can run it so that the analysis will be again being done. So whenever you want to save that file, syntax editor, you can have it as extension as .sps. Now there is a script window. In the script window, you can write all the program like in a basic language. And when you want to save it, you have to save it as, it will have the extension as .sbs. Okay, so these were the four windows. Now let us see what is a data editor window. I have already told you that it has two views. One is a data view and variable view. Say that there are two sheets, like two sheets it comes, data view and variable view. In the data view window, you have to enter the data assets, data values. And whenever you have to, that variable data will be having many, suppose you are entering the marks of students, So you will have your name, student name, admission number, and marks in different subjects. So the name of the student, admission number, these are all comes as variable names. Whatever the whatever be the name, whatever be the admission number, whatever be his or her marks, it comes as our data values. So in data window, all these values appear, and in variable view, you will have the name of this variables. So in when you have a data view window, you have can see that below there comes a variable view. So just clicking on that, you will be able to get the variable view window open. Okay, so let us see what is a variable view window now. Okay, this is a data window. Here we will have the data values, and in variable view window we will have variable values. So I have started entering some student's name, admission number, their gender, like that. So it is a data view window. Okay, here the data values are coming, and the variable names. What are the variable names over here? Student name, admission number, gender,
no.
Marks in maths.
Huh.
Okay, these mark max, I have put it as mark max.
Huh.
Day zero, all these comes as variable names. But when I am entering the data, I will be using this window. Okay, data view window. In here, I will be entering the data, whatever be the name, I will be entering over here. Okay, now let us see, there are many things. In variable view, you can see there are name, type, width, decimals, labels, values, missing, many things are there. So let us see what all these things means. So in variable view window, first column, name. In that place, you have to enter the variable name. Whenever you enter variable name, it should start with the alphabet. And after that, you are allowed to use numerals also. But the special characters other than underscore is not allowed. So you are not able to use space. Okay. And the length, how many characters you can use? Up to 64 characters. So you are permitted to use up to 64 characters for naming the variables. And if you want, you think that, suppose that I am giving the name as BW. And if I want to know what it is, I can use label later. Okay, in label I can give the full expansion of the name. But actual variable name is allowed in the column name. So that has to be restriction that it only takes up to 64 characters. Now, there is something type. Type means name, it is a string variable. So, whenever you enter the name, student's name as a variable, variable name, you have to enter it Ashlyn, Joseph, Matthew, all these names has to be entered. So, we consider it as a string type. But when you want to enter some values like marks in maths. Okay, so that comes as a numeric value. So that type of the variable is described in the column type in variable view window. Then what is meant by width? So it tells you how many characters are allowed to enter for that variable. Suppose that, for example, suppose that I'm taking this window. Now, suppose that in the string here with this, I have put it as 19. Instead, suppose that I am putting it here. Default, it will come as 8. So, I am putting it as 8 itself. Now, let me enter the name. It is shown as Elizabeth. Full name is not there. So, if I am entering it fresh, I will have gives a beep sound because it doesn't allow more than 8 characters to enter. That is fixed. That's the width. So what I have to do? I have to increase it. So I'm increasing it, and again I am going to data view. Let me try typing it now. Elizabeth Matthew. Okay, I'm able to enter the full name, Elizabeth Matthew. So it determines what is the width. Width means the number of characters which you are allowed to enter for that variable. Okay, so it tells you determine the number of characters SPSS will allow to be entered for that variable. Now there is something decimals. You know what is decimal. So how many number of decimals are allowed, that you can fix. It can be in for string, you don't have any decimals. But if you are entering body weight, you can have up to 2 decimals. By default, it comes as 2. But if you want more decimal, 4, 5, like that, you can change the value to that one. And anyway, it has to be less than or equal to 16. That is the maximum permitted number of decimals. Okay. Now comes label. I have already told you, suppose that I am writing student name and I have to write it fully, name of the student. So I will write it over here in this label. Okay, up to 256 characters can be entered in label. So it is very important sometimes, because suppose that you are using BW. Okay, I want to denote body weight by BW. Some people would like to denote birth weight by BW. So sometimes it is very important to specify the label. So this label is printed in the output when that variable is used. Now comes values. So values, suppose that I'm entering the data, means I'm noting down what is the gender of the person. So for example, suppose that I have this as gender as a variable over here. I'm putting it as numeric. And what I will do is, here I'm coding it as 1 as male and 2 as females. How will I do it? Okay, so I click over here. So a window gets open. I will write 1, and here I'm going to put 1 as male. So I type 1 as 1 male and put add, click add. Okay, then I click 2, female, female. And so it has been assigned. And the advantage of this is, so now when I want to enter the data, I have to just click over here and I can select it. Otherwise, what I can do is, I can enter the value 1. Okay, here what happens is, when I view value labels, if I uncheck this, you will have the value as 2, 1, 2, like that. Okay, so if you want to enter it as 1, 2, 1, 2, like that, if you have coded and you're going to enter, this might be okay. I'm checking the value label. But if you are going to select and do it, you check the value label, so it appears. And from here, you can select male or female, and you can go with the entry of the data. So like this, you can enter the data in an SPSS. Okay. Now, there are more things in SPSS. Anyway, so due to lack of time, I'm not going to explain everything. Only the thing is that if you have a missing value, you can specify that value, so that what happens is, sometimes the person who enters the data may miss to enter the data, or the person who responded in the according to the questionnaire and the survey might not have given any answers. So in order to distinguish that, it is better if you enter a discrete missing value if needed. If needed, you have to enter the for missing observation, how you want to represent it, that can be coded, that can be written over here. Okay, that can be selected. Now column comes, how many here when you see in the variable view, sorry, in data view, here it takes a lot of space, but here there is only small space is there. So when you increase this width columns, what happens is in the data view the space is, the space for the cell increases. You can do it by just clicking over here like this also. So in variable view you can see it is getting increased. So that's what it. Then align, you can align values to the right, left, all those things. This measure we will see later. So that is also important. Here we can nominal, ordinal, or scale value. Okay. So this is given as numeric. So you can see it like this over here. Now, usually, whenever a researcher approaches you for analysis, they will be having data in Excel file. So, what you have to do is, you have to check with them, the whatever be the data they have entered in the ensure that the first row is taken from giving the variable. Second row on enter the array. For example, this is an Excel file, you can see it. Here, what I have used, in the first row, I have given all the variable names. From second row onwards, I have entered the data values. It is better if you have it in this format, because this can be imported into one SPSS. Okay, so this Excel file, let us open it in SPSS. So what we have to do? We have to go to file, open data, choose Excel as file type, and select the file you want to import, then click open. So it will get opened in your Excel. So it will ask you whether read or you want to give the names of the variable from the first row of data. So if you have checked it, it will be taken it like that. And if you uncheck it, it will take only it as a value of the variable, and it will assign itself some variable names. Okay, so it's always better to have variable names in the first row of the Excel file. Then percentage of the values determine the data type, all those things are there. Then if you click OK, that file will get opened in SPSS. So let us check it. Okay, so file, open, data. Okay, now it by default it comes SPSS statistics. Now I have changed to file as type Excel. So many Excel files in the desktop is being shown. So for this class, I have prepared statistical computing. So I'm taking it as selected it. Now I click open. It will take time, some time, depending on the speed of the computer, but it will get open. That window will come, and then if I click OK, the values will be there. Okay. It takes larger than usual. Okay. Then if I click OK, the data will come over here. So by default it is selecting sheet 1. I have only data in sheet 1. If you have in Excel more than sheets, you can have. And if your data is in any other sheet, you can specify over here and you can select that sheet. All these things are possible. So when you have a spaces with you, check it out. Okay. If I click OK, it will be depicted over here. I'm not going to do that. Other than that, I will show you how I have taken it. Okay, so same the data, I have already taken it and it's over here. Okay, so this is how it will appear. This is the data view. If you go for the variable view, you have the list of all these names over here. And automatically it has given some labels. Usually it won't be. And different scales are also being shown here. So everything is there. Okay. Now, you know what is meant by statistics. You are all statistics students. So what statistician do? You have to collect the data first. After collecting the data, you have to summarize the data. And then if needed, you have to go for some analysis. And whatever be the result you have to interpret it. This is the process through which we are going on, isn't it? So when you have collected the data on each and every value of the population, like complete enumeration or census, you have to use only what descriptive statistics. Okay, so in descriptive statistics, what we do, it deals with numerical and graphical procedures to summarize a collection of data in an understandable way. And when you are taking only a sample, and when you want to tell about the population, you go through the inferential statistics. There you come across with most of the statistical tests. So for that, let us think how the data is classified. First it has categorical, then quantitative, and also you know that there is nominal, ordinal, interval and ratio. And in the nominal level, what all things comes? Breed of cow, color of the eye, gender, religion, all these comes as a nominal. Your admission number, your name, all these are comes under nominal scale. Okay, if you are assigning any number, it is only for identification. And ordinal means, suppose that you are grading the class of a teacher in the scale of 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Or you are rating the product like 1, 2, 3, 5, 5 star means it is a very good product, like that. All these values or your entrance rank, all these are ordinal measurements. We are assigning numbers and it has a definite order. And there comes interval and ratio. And in the interval, the zero is set arbitrarily. And in ratio scale, weight equal to zero. Weight is a ratio scale. So zero means there is no weight. But temperature zero means there is temperature itself. Okay. So that is the difference between interval and ratio scale. And almost all statistical tests, all the calculations, you are permitted to do it in interval scale. And when you want to describe a set of observation with one value, you know, measures central tendency is there, and based on whether this type of data, whether it is ratio and interval data, and whether it follows normal distribution. Okay, in that case, into describe group, you are using mean and standard deviation, and you might be using parametric test. But if it is not following ratio or interval data, it is not following normal distribution, you are not permitted to use parametric test. You might be using non-parametric test, isn't it? Okay, so this is a slide telling you about that, but I'm not going to describe it more because you are all statistics students and you know all these things. So descriptive statistics, you have measure central tendency, dispersion, skewness and kurtosis, and you know all these measures of central tendency. Okay, and there are many measures of dispersion, range, standard deviation. And when you go for relative measures of dispersion, you have coefficient of variation, like that you have studied many measures of dispassion also, and you have seen this measure of skewness. So depending on its value, we say that whether it is symmetric or positively skewed or negatively skewed. And measure of kurtosis, you might have studied it as beta equal to 3, beta 2 less than 3, beta 2 greater than 0, like that. But when you do some calculation is an SPSS, it will be showing an only positive, negative or zero value. So what it is that it is based on these calculation. It is calculating beta 2 minus 3, whether it is greater than 0, leptokurtic, that is positive. Less than 0 means it is negative, then we say that it is platykurtic. Equal to 0, there is no change, it is mesokurtic. Okay. Now, how to do a descriptive analysis in SPSS? So, let us check it. So, we have data over here. I have admission number, gender, class, rate. Okay, you are rating the class of a teacher like this. Size of the shoes, marks of students. Okay, suppose that you want to analyze it. So, in case of nominal data, what is the preferred measure of central tendency? I think some of you can answer. Somebody please. Preferred measure of central tendency in case of a nominal data. Or how will you represent a nominal data? With a single value, which measure of central tendency will be preferring? Somebody please answer. Okay, ഒരുപാട് സമയം എടുക്കില്ല, വേഗം പറയൂ. മീൻ മീഡിയൻ മോഡ് എല്ലാം കണ്ടുപിടിക്കാൻ പറ്റുമോ? മോഡ്, യെസ്, വെരി ഗുഡ്. മോഡ് ഈസ് ദ പ്രിഫേർഡ് മെഷർ ഓഫ് സെൻട്രൽ ടെൻഡൻസി. കാരണം ഇപ്പൊ നിങ്ങൾക്ക് അറിയാം, ഇഫ് ഇറ്റ് ഇസ് എ കളർ ഓഫ് ദ ഐ, അല്ലെങ്കിൽ ജെൻഡർ, ജെൻഡർ ഒക്കെയാകുമ്പോൾ യു ക്യാൻ സീ വിച്ച് ഇസ് ദ വാട്ട് ഇസ് ദ മോസ്റ്റ് ഒക്യൂറിംഗ് ജെൻഡർ, whether it is male or female, that might be, we might be telling about that only. Or you can, what you can do is you can tell about the proportions only, but it is not a measure of central tendency. As a measure of central tendency, we will be projecting only the mode. Okay, so let us first see what is descriptive statistics. Frequencies I have taken. So for gender and class rate, it is rating from only 1 to 5. So it might be better to go for frequency tables. And there is sometimes there won't be any meaning in. If it is an ordinal data, preferred measure of central tendency is median. Okay, mean is not meaningful in that case. Okay, so in that this case, let us take median and mode. And you can go for minimum, maximum, and also range. Okay, so let us continue. Click OK. This was the statistics. If you need to go for charts, the option is there. You can select and you can continue. I'm taking only this much over here. Okay, so SPSS process is ready. So I have an output window opened over here. All the results gone over there. So this is the frequency. There are 13 females, 12 males. And this is the frequency of class rate. The students rated, 7 students rated. For each 3, 4 and 5, we got 7 as frequency. And shoe size, the most used shoe size for that particular class is 13. Okay, so like that, you, with the frequency tables, you can show the data. Okay, we were thinking about median and mode. So here comes gender, as I have called it as F and M. They haven't given any mode like that. it has to be numeral at least. So class weight I have 4 is the median, shoe size 5 is the median. For shoe size mode is also 5, but in case of class weight they have written 3 as mode, but we know that, and they have written multiple mode exist. So 3, 4, 7, 3, 4 and 5, I think both they were all modes. Okay, so they were all repeated 7 times. That is the mostly frequently occurring values. Okay, so like this you can go through descriptive statistics. And if it is a continuous data, here what I have done is I have done go to the menu bar, analyze descriptive statistics, and from here I have taken frequencies. That's how I have reached to find out this frequency table. Now clicking on the star, go to the data. So here I go, and here suppose I want to find out the descriptive statistics for mark, analyze, descriptive statistics. I would like to use descriptives over here, and marks in marks is written over here, and as option I would like to take mean, standard deviation, minimum and maximum. And if it is a sample data, I might be interested in finding out standard error of mean. Okay, all these things which we need, we can select and click continue, then click OK. You will have the output like this. Okay, here I have 25 values. Minimum value is 30, maximum is 99, statistic mean or statistic sample mean is this one, and standard error of sample mean is over here, and this is the standard deviation. So it is very simple. You have to go to analyze descriptive statistics. Frequencies was taken for like ordinal and nominal cells. I have nominal variables, I have taken frequencies. But when it was a continuous data, or I think it is ratio or interval scale, I have gone for descriptives. Okay. Now, similarly, I can use this something like explore you have seen. With that also, I am able to find out the descriptives. Okay. So here, again, I go take marks in maths. Statistics, it gives you all descriptives. It is clicked over. If you need percentiles and all, you can select that. Now, if I am interested in histogram, and if I want to test whether the data follows a normal distribution, I would like to go with it. Normality plot with test. So, what I have done? Analyze descriptive statistics, explore. From that, I have gone to this one, selected the dependent list. What are be the one I want to check for whether the normal data is following normal, or for which I want to find out the descriptives. I have selected it, and if you need to go for box plot, you can do it. Everything is possible, so you can use it like this. Now I click continue, click OK. So we have lot of outputs now. Okay, so all these things, mean, lower bound of mean, upper bound of mean, everything is over here. Skewness, kurtosis, almost all things comes over here. And when you want to test for normality, the result comes over here. So the value, this is the p-value, sig. Sig is written as the p-value. So as per Shapiro-Wilk test, we are getting the value as 0.6. So it is greater than 0.05. So we say that the data H naught is actually for normality test. The data is following a normal distribution, and the alternate hypothesis is data is not following normal distribution. So we get that the data is following a normal distribution as the p value is greater than 0.05. Okay, any doubts up to this? So when you have SPSS with you, you tried all these things. This is a box plot. So the median is this value and all these things you might have studied. So go through the notes and try to do and interpret the same. Okay, is it okay for you, all of you? Are you following me or not?
Yes, madam.
Thank you, sir. So let us check a problem. I want answer from students, because anyway, in this question, the answer is already given. So suppose that I have observations from 15 experimental units like this, and I want to test whether the population mean is 65. Which test I will be using? We don't have many. സമയം കുറവാണ്, വേഗം കുട്ടികൾ ഉത്തരം പറയണം. സ്റ്റുഡൻസ് പ്ലീസ്, ചാറ്റിൽ ഇട്ടിട്ടുണ്ടോ ഉത്തരം? എനിക്കറിയില്ല, ചാറ്റ് ഞാൻ കാണുന്നില്ല. ഓക്കെ, ടി ടെസ്റ്റ് തന്നെയാണ്. വിച്ച് ടി ടെസ്റ്റ്? ടി ടെസ്റ്റിൽ ഏത് വരും? ഓക്കെ, വൺ സാമ്പിൾ ടി ടെസ്റ്റ് ആണ്. ഓക്കെ, വൺ സാമ്പിൾ ടി ടെസ്റ്റ് ആണ് നമ്മൾ യൂസ് ചെയ്യേണ്ടത്. സോ ഹൗ ടു ഡു ഇറ്റ് എന്നുള്ളതാണ് അവിടെ തന്നിരിക്കുന്നത്. സോ യു നോ ദാറ്റ് ഇറ്റ് കംസ് അണ്ടർ പാരാമെട്രിക് ടെസ്റ്റ്. ഓക്കെ, സോ പാരാമെട്രിക് ടെസ്റ്റ് അസ്യൂംസ് ദാറ്റ് ദ ഡാറ്റ ഫോളോസ് എ പെർട്ടിക്കുലർ ഡിസ്ട്രിബ്യൂഷൻ ആൻഡ് ദ ഡാറ്റ ഹാസ് ബീൻ ഒബ്ടെയ്ൻ യൂസിംഗ് റാൻഡം സാമ്പിളിംഗ് ടെക്നിക്. ആൻഡ് ദെൻ ദിസ് ഇസ് ദ മെത്തേഡ് ഫോർ കാൽക്കുലേഷൻ ഓഫ് ടി ടെസ്റ്റ്. So hope you remember all these things. So the statistic, all these things are there. So now let us check how to do it with SPSS. So we have the data which has been shown over here. So we have, this is the data. Are you able to see the data? Shall I will talk in the video? This is yield. Yield values are there, and I want to test whether the yield is 65. Okay, so analyze, compare means. So here I go for analyze, compare means, and I have to select what test, one sample t test. So analyze, compare means, one sample t test. It is selected. And this yield was our variable under study, so it has been moved to test variable. By just clicking over here, it has been moved to test variable, and I am putting it test value as 65. Just I will click OK. So this is the process. We have gone analyze, compare means, one sample t test. Okay. Then I have selected the variable to be studied or to test variable, and put the test value as 65. Then clicked OK. So this is the result. Here you can see the mean, standard deviation, and standard error of mean. The t value is over here. Degrees of freedom is over here. This is the significance. What we conclude from this? The significance value or p value, it is showing the p value. What we do usually, if we want to tell about at 5% level of significance whether to accept or reject the null hypothesis, if p value is greater than 0.05, we say that the null hypothesis is accepted. Okay, p greater than 0.05, we say that the null hypothesis accepted at 5% level of significance. If p is less than 0.05, we say that the null hypothesis rejected at 5% level of significance. So here I get the p value as 0.277, so it is greater than 0.05, so I conclude that what should I conclude? H naught is accepted. So what is our H naught? Mu equal to 65. What does it mean? The sample. We have the sample, and we are talking about whenever you do inferential statistic based on the sample, you are talking about the population. So that we say that the population mean is 65. So the sample comes from a population having a mean, population mean of 65. That is what we conclude from this. Is it clear? Okay. Now let us see this problem. Here, milk yield data recorded before treatment and after treatment is given. Which might be the statistical test you will use? Any idea? Yes, very good. PAT test. You will be using PAT test for the same, because from the same animal you have two observations. So there is some dependency between these observations. In that case, you have to take care of that dependency. So you have to use PAT test. So this is the way in which PAT test is designed, isn't it? The sample size is small, difference is normally distributed, and you have this test statistic and all those things like this. Now let us do it. So here I have the data. This is the animal ID, this is before values, and this is after values. So I want to check whether there is any significant difference between these values before and after the treatment or after the experiment. So we are going for Paired samples t-test. So analyze, compare means paired sample t-test. What we are doing? Analyze, compare means paired sample t-test. Just click on that. Now I am taking the value before to this position, and the next variable to be compared with that, paired with that, is after. So those two, by clicking on this, those two variables are moved to here. Now just click OK in options 95% interval. Yes, that's okay. Then click OK. So it is giving you the mean. This is the output, mean before and after. Standard error of mean is also there. And what is the relationship between these two? These two are, this correlation is significant. So there is relation between these two variables. And we have, this is the result, difference of means, standard deviation of difference, standard error of difference of means, and lower confidence level and upper confidence level, T value, and we have the degrees of freedom as 11. Now this is the significant. The significant value is 0.023, isn't it? So based on this, what we will do, whether we accept H naught or reject H naught? Expecting an answer from you. Accept H naught or reject H naught? So at 5% level of significance, if p value is greater than 0.05, we will accept. If p value is less than 0.05, we will reject. Okay, so at 5% level, since this p value is less than 0.05, isn't it? So we will reject it. Reject at 5% level. Null hypothesis is rejected at 5% level of significance. But if you are thinking about 1% level of significance, this 0.023 is greater than 0.01. So at 1% level of significance, you are going to accept it, isn't it? So that is the conclusion from this result. So it is very important that you should know whether to accept H naught and whether to reject H naught based on the P value. You must know it, and how to interpret the result in a more beautiful way that we have to learn. Okay, so we have seen this. So 0.023 was less than 0.05. So there is significant difference between mean milk yield before and after the treatment. That was the conclusion. Now, what we will do with this problem? The following data give milk yield of two breeds A and B. Okay. Now we want to test whether these breeds are significantly different in their average milk yield. So which test you will use? Anybody please? Okay. It is two groups, two different groups, because there are two different breeds, isn't it? Two type of cows, different type of cows. So breed A and breed B means two different, there is nothing which pairs them. Then we will be using independent t-test. Okay, we will be using independent t-test. These are two independent groups, and we want to compare the means of these two groups. So whenever you go for independent t-test, first you want to know whether the variances of these two different groups, independent groups, are same or not. For that we will be using f-test. You know f-test, and this, based on this f-test, based on the p-value of f over here in SPSS, we will decide whether to accept or reject the hypothesis that variances of two groups are same. Then after that we go for testing equality of means. So it is very important, because the test statistic being used when variances are equal is this one, but when the variances are not equal, we will have a different test statistics. That's why it has been written differently. So now let us go with our example. The sample size is small and we can use independent t-test, and there are two groups which are independent. So, and here what is important is how to enter the data. In case of yield, we just have entered the data like this. When you were decided to do pair t-test, we have one column for before and one column for after. But when we are dealing with independent t-test, in within one column I am writing, sorry, this is the one, within one column I am writing the breed A and breed B. So it is written in one column. Okay, the treatment groups are written in one column, and corresponding values for of these animals, of those animals, are written over here as milk yield, with the name milk yield. So this is the column, these are the two columns I am referring. Okay, so in independent t-test we are entering the data like this, one column for breed and another column for the response variable milk yield. Okay, so after this again you have to go analyze, compare means, and you have to take independent samples t-test. Okay, now we have breed as grouping variable. We have to define groups. I have put breed over here. Now I have to define this. I have group 1 as A and I am putting group 2 as B and clicking continue. Okay, click continue. Now this might be my data, milk yield. Now I just click OK. Do I have to go for options? No. Click OK. So milk yield, the number of animals in each group, mean of the milk yield, standard deviation, standard error of mean, all these are displayed over here. And first it shows milk yield equal variance assumed and equal variances not assumed. And this is the result of F. Okay, so Levin's test for equality of variance. And here is the P value for F test. So it is 0.95. So what should I conclude? Whether the variance are equal or not? P value is greater than 0.05. So what does it mean? Accept H naught or reject H naught? Accept H naught, isn't it? So I'm concluding that the variances of two groups are same. So here I have to look at this row, equal variances assumed. And you can see this is the T value for comparison. This 0.078 is greater than 0.05, isn't it? So what should we conclude? What should we conclude? Accept. We are going to accept that H naught, that means there is no significant difference in milk yield of two groups of breeds. Okay, two breeds. Like that we have to conclude. Okay. Now, here we have, suppose that we have four different breeds or four different varieties, and suppose that this is the yield. If it is a cow, we can think about it as a milk yield of four different breeds. Now I want to compare whether there is significant difference between milk yield of these different breeds. So what should be the method to be used? Yes, very good. It is ANOVA. Okay, very good. It is ANOVA. We will be using one-way ANOVA for the same. So you know how to, this is the model for one-way ANOVA and this is the ANOVA table, isn't it? You know all those things. So let us do a problem. So here, this is the data arrangement. We have 1, 2, 3, 4. Okay, so I have four breeds, so I have coded it as 1, 2, 3 and 4, and corresponding to each breed, I have written their milk yield values. Okay, here yield ANOVA. Like that I have written the milk yield values of these cows. The whole data is written entered over here. Now again, what we want to do? We want to do one-way ANOVA only. So again, analyze, compare means there is one-way ANOVA. Okay, compare means one-way ANOVA. So this window gets open. So there is our treatment. So this is our treatment. That is the factor. Okay, factor to be compared. And this is the dependent variable or response variable is coded as, named as yield ANOVA, or putting it over here. Now, if there was significant difference between this group, I may have to use post hoc test. So that from this, I may select, depending on my preference, I will be taking some of this test from here and I will be clicking continue. And if I need, I can check, or we have to check whether the data is following normal distribution, whether there is significant difference between variances. All this we have to check. So that can be checked by using this. Okay, then click continue. Then when I click OK, I will get the result. Okay, so it says that gives you descriptive statistics over here. And homogeneity variance, there is no significant difference between variance. So you have to check the assumptions of ANOVA. It will be normal. You have to check with it Shapiro-Wilk test or Kolmogorov-Smirnov test where the data is following normal distribution, that you can be checked using explore, analyze, descriptive statistics, explore. Now here there is no significant difference. Here this is ANOVA table, sum of squares, degrees of freedom, mean square, F value and the significance value. So you are getting 0.34 as significance. So it is again greater than 0.05, means that there is no significant difference between different breeds in terms of their milk yield. Okay, so no need for any post hoc comparison test. So that's why it comes as in the same column. If there were significant difference, you will be getting it in different columns. Okay, this is how you will do one way ANOVA. Now let us check with another problem. So and LSD is preferred when we are concentrating on the null hypothesis, and usually Tucky test is preferred when you are concentrating on alternative hypothesis, or which one we are more interested. Okay, now this is the next problem. So what might be the method for this? We have five different varieties and we have five blocks also, and I want to check whether there is significant difference between varieties. So which method of analysis I should use? So here also I have to use ANOVA only. So we have to use ANOVA, but it is two-way ANOVA. So for this, you have studied all these things. So let me move. So analyze here from two-way ANOVA onwards, you have to use analyze general linear model. Okay. Analyze general linear model, you have to select only, in this case, only univariate, general linear model, univariate. Then for here, you have to move our dependent variable. Here our dependent variable is fodder yield. So you have to look at how the data is arranged. So here, there are five blocks. Okay, there are five blocks. So they are numbered 1, 2, 3, 4 and 5 is also there. And variety, I have 5 varieties. I have written it as 1, 2, 3, 4. Took one column for block, one column for variety and entered the data response variable value correspondingly ended as fodder yield. Okay. And then when I want to do the analysis, dependent variable is fodder yield. And fixed factors, I am taking block and variety. That's to here. Then model, I am taking it as custom. And main factors is taken as block and variety. Continue. So model, we have taken block and variety. And post hoc comparison, if needed, we have to select. Before I go for variety only, I want to test whether there is significant difference between variety only, and I'm just selecting only Dungan, then putting continue. Now just click let me click OK. So the results come over here. Here you have block 0.476, block value significance is 0.476. So you have all sum of squares, degrees of freedom, means sum of squares, everything is here. F value is over here and this is the p value, and depending on the p value, variety, whether there is significant difference between variety, yes or no. So there is p value is less than 0.05, so we can see that there is significant difference between varieties. So when you want to do compare them, you can see Duncan is showing this table. It means that two subsets are created. So it shows you that the fourth variety is significantly different from all other varieties, and there is no significant difference between the variety 1, 2, 3 and 5, whereas the variety 4 is significantly different from all other varieties. That's how we get the result. So this is how we do ANOVA. Now we are jumping to non-parametric test. So non-parametric test, this is one problem. So a teacher is calling students from her class, and this is the order MFF, like that. She means a person noted this, whether she is calling out male or female, and she got this order, and he want to check whether she had called the students male and female in a random or not. Okay, the sequence in which teacher calls on males and females is random or not. So what might be the test? It will be a non-parametric test. And could you remember the name of the test? Anyone? Okay, it is run test. Very good. It is run test. So we will be using test to test whether the order of occurrence of two values of a variable is random. We will be using run test. A run is a sequence of like observation, or too many or too few runs suggest that some sample is not random. So now let us check with the data. So here the SPSS, we cannot code it as M and F, and we cannot do it like that. So what I have done is I have coded them 1 and 2, 1 for male and 2 for female I have written. I want to check for this data whether the selection is at random or not. So I want to go for analyze non-parametric test. I have two options. I can go with one sample, or I can go with legacy dialogues. In this case, let us go for legacy dialog, and I select runs. This gives you the run test. So now analyze non-parametric test, legacy dialog, runs. That is what is being selected. Okay. So this again, an active window appears. So what is selection is my variable. Okay, now I want to check, there should be a cut point. Okay, now let us click OK and let us see what happens. So it has taken test value as 2, values less than 2, values greater than or equal to 2. That is being taken. So the values is 11 comes in over here. And total cases, there were 22 cases. Number of runs is 13. So it concludes that the significance is obtained as 0.827. So it means that p-value is greater than 0.05. So it tells you that the teacher calls students at random. Okay. So it is, the null hypothesis is being accepted over here. Now let us check with another problem. So here we have to find out the effectiveness of a program. So 2 years, last year value, percentage of successful interventions were taken, and a program was implemented. And again, they are taking after the program, they are taking this year's percentage of successful interventions. And we want to compare these group, this year values and last year percentage of successful interventions. So which test you will use? Any idea? first column, participant means 1, 2, 3. These represent actually different schools. So from each school, we are getting two values. One is of this year and other is of last year. Okay, we will be using Wilcoxon sign rank test. Okay, which is equivalent to parity test. So let us check how to do it. Very good. Somebody has responded. Priyanka has been responded. She has responded to many questions. So here is our data, participant, last year and this year values. So we go to again analyze, non-parametric test, only two groups. So let us go for legacy dialog. And here it comes two related samples, isn't it? Two related samples. So we can select this. Last year value is taken over there. This year value is to be taken. Wilcoxon is clicked. And then you can click OK. Okay. So it gives you the negative ranks, positive ranks, everything is given. And based on the p-value, what you get? The p-value is 0.041. So according to this, we are going to p-value is less than 0.05, isn't it? So there is significant difference between this year and last year's percentage of successful interventions. P-value is less than 0.05. So we are not accepting H naught, we are rejecting H naught. It means there is some significant difference between percentage of successful intervention in last year and this year. So SPSS is testing only
It seems like Ms. is having some network issues.
Okay. Am I audible?
Yes.
Okay, so we were talking about Wilcoxon sign rank test, isn't it? I think it has been completed and up to that you were able to see, isn't it? Ini enke chat box ile ningal parayunnathu kaanan pattilla kaato. You have to tell with your voice. Am I audible? Are you able to see my screen? Yes.
Yes.
Yes. Okay. Yes. Very good. Wilcoxon sign rank test. Where are we? Covered. The. All of them. Conducted. Conducted. All. എവിടെ വരെ കണ്ടത്
യെസ് യെസ് വിൽകോക്സൺ
സൈൻ റാങ്ക് സം ടെസ്റ്റിന്റെ റിസൾട്ട് വരെ കണ്ടു ഇല്ലേ യെസ് താങ്ക്യൂ അപ്പോൾ നമ്മൾ വി ആർ ഗോയിങ് ടു ദി നെക്സ്റ്റ് പ്രോബ്ലം so this is another problem we have two different methods and it has been assigned to two different group of students and they were tested by using a reading comprehension test and their marks are given over here now we want to check whether which method is better okay so which test we will use we will be using Mann-Whitney U test okay we will be using Mann-Whitney U test So let us see how to do it. So this is the data. Here also, like in case of independent tests, we have a column with the method 1 and 2, and we have test marks for the same. Now what we do? We simply go for analyze, non-parametric test, legacy dialogues. We have two independent samples. We can select it, and grouping variable is method over here. So here we select method to here, and our test mark to this test variable say list. Method is not defined by me. Okay, so it is 1 and it is 2. Okay, continue. Now click OK. Then the result comes. So this is mean rank, sum of ranks, everything is there. Mann-Whitney U value, Wilcox and W value is also there. So depending on the significance value, again you can check the significance value. P value is less than 0.05. So it means that there is significant difference between two methods. This is how we do the analysis. Is it clear? Okay. Now let us go to the next method. Another problem. So here, suppose that we have three groups, and we have the values on three groups, and actually it is a data on people were classified as high, medium, and low, and then their self confidence scores were obtained, and they have it has been mirrored to ordinal data. And now we want to check whether there is significant difference between these three groups. So there are more than two groups. So we are not going to use Mann-Whitney U test, but we will be able to use test known as Kruskal-Wallis test. It is equivalent to our one-way ANOVA. So if we are not able, assumptions of ANOVA is not satisfied. In that case, we will be going for this method, which is known as Kruskal-Wallis test. Okay, so let us. When I do Kruskal-Wallis test, again, I have the data. Just after this, here I have three groups: low, medium, high. So they have coded as 1, 2, and 3 within one variable named group. And these are the self-confidence scores given against each value as their ordinal scores. Now I prefer not to go by legacy dialogues. Again, I have to go analyze, non-parametric test, and I will be going for their independent samples, isn't it? So I instead of going legacy dialogues also, you have K independent samples. You can use that for the analysis. But I prefer to go by this one, independent samples. Let us see how it is being done. So here, this I go to field. Here I will be taking the group as our into this position. Okay. and ordinal score was the okay, sorry. Network issue, Anna. I was using my phone for the class, so that's why it comes. There was a break when I got a call from higher authorities. Okay. Screen thaanu nunda le. Ipa kaana bollo.
Yes, ma'am.
Yes. Okay. Let me move. So we were talking about Kruskal Wallis test. So we have gone for field and selected this group and ordinal score settings. In this, let me customize my test. Otherwise, without customize also, you can run the test. It will appropriately select the correct method for the analysis. Anyway, now I am going to show you the Kruskal Wallis test. Why I have chosen this one is I want to do the multiple comparison, because which group is different from other ones, that I want to know. That's why I have used this method. If you have gone through legacy methods, we won't be able to do it. Now I click run. So the result comes, isn't it? Come over here. So actually it is rejecting the null hypothesis. So you can see the distribution of ordinal score is same across categories of groups. That was our null hypothesis, and we have rejected the null hypothesis. Now I double click on this. Another active window is getting opened. Now in this, I will go over here and I will select pairwise comparisons. So what happens if I am selecting pairwise comparison? It will be showing the significant values over here. So based on this, 3-2 significance is greater than 0.05. So no difference between the method 3 and 2. 3-1, it is less than 0.05, so there is significant difference between 3 and 1. When you compare 2 and 1, it is greater than 0.05, no difference between 2 and 1. Okay, so what we conclude is, the method 1 is significantly different from 3, but there is no difference between 2 and 3, and there is no difference between 1 and 2. That's how we conclude. Okay, so like this, you have to report and you have to tell more about the analysis or interpret the result. Now let me introduce one more method. Suppose that we were making a new product and we want to taste and find out which one is better. So same person is given these three products and their score, we ask them to rate it in within 1 to 10 scale. So they have rated the product like this. Okay, depending on its appearance, sensory evaluation, we say that. Like this, they have given the score. Now we want to know which product is better. So for this, we will be using which method? Friedman test. Okay, so whenever you use Friedman test, so the samples are, or the groups are related, because we are taking the same person. We are asking the same person to taste it. So we go over here, analyze, again, we go for non-parametric test, related samples. We are selecting related samples, fields. I have to, here you like in case of more than pair t-test, we have three columns telling our product results from product 1, 2 and 3. They are adjacent columns. Okay, then we go for settings. So depending on our data, we can select that method, or it will give you the method. So here I am telling you about only Friedman analysis, and I need pairwise comparison also. I selected it and run it. So again, it is going to reject the method. So when you double click on this, again model a view comes, and there you can see pairwise comparison, and you can say which method is better than the other one. Okay, it takes time. Similarly, so that's about fragment test. Let me wait for the result to come. Okay, here model view came, I think. So you go for pairwise comparisons. Now you can see actually this, there is difference between product 3 and 1. There is no difference between product 3 and 2. There is no difference between product 2 and 1. Like that we are getting the result according to this pairwise comparison. Now what all things is remaining? In non-parametric test, you know how to do, or you have to know how to do chi-square test. So when we have a problem on like this, chi-square test is used for goodness of fit test and also for testing independence of association. So when you want to go for the goodness of fit test, for like this, these are the frequency, and we will say that whether it occurs in the ratio of 9:3:2. So for non-parametric test, legacy paradox, there you can see a chi-square test. So the test variable, this data, for this one problem is the here actual data, we are taking it as, it is not the actual data from a survey or not. We are we have to go for data, go to data, take weight cases, and weight cases by frequency variable. Okay, here I have taken the frequency. Okay, so again I go to the data. So here phenotypes, there are 4 types of phenotypes, 1, 2, 3, 4, and its frequency is written. Now I will go for, this is how the data is to be arranged: legacy dialogues, non-parametric test, legacy dialogues, chi-square, and we have to take their phenotype. That is our variable. It comes with a weight now. Where is phenotype? Okay. Taken over here. We are not taking, if we are thinking that all categories are equal, you can click on that. But instead of that, I have a ratio 9:3:1. So I will value is given 9 first. Then I give the value 3, add. Now next comes, next 3, add. Next comes 9:3:1, I think, isn't it? So 1, add. Now it will be checking this one. Exact, if needed, I can give, otherwise, okay, asymptotic only, okay. So small data. What happened? You have the observed value, this is the expected value, this is the chi-square value, and see that it is going along with the theoretical frequencies, because the significance is greater than 0.05. we are concluding that the H0 is being accepted, that is the theoretical, they are in the ratio 9:3:3:1. Okay, it occurs in the ratio 9:3:3:1, that is being accepted. Now when you have a chi-square test to test association, what you have to do, you will be having 2 or more groups, like this one. Okay, so we have age groups and high attitude. And whenever you do analysis, what you have to do? You have to go to analyze, descriptive statistics. Difference is that we have to go to analyze descriptive statistics, and then we have to go to cross tabs. In the cross tabs, you have let me give age group in again. There is a problem because we have our data is represented here as 1 2 1 2 1 2. Data arrangement is very important, and age group is given as 1 2 3 4 5. 5 age group is there. This 1 represent low, 2 represent medium, sorry, high. Age group, 5 age groups were there, that is there. And I have given the frequency represented in the table over here. So what we have to do first, again we have to data, go to data, weight cases. So weight cases by this frequency. So this frequency comes as over here as this one. So go to weight cases by this is to go over here and this is to come over here. Okay, then click OK. So it has given those weights. Now you can go analyze descriptive statistics, cross tabs. So that's it. We take age group. Let me take into column, attitude to rows. I can again statistics. I go for chi square. Nothing more. Then cells, if I need observed row column percentage, what all things I need, I can give. Okay. And if it is a big data, I can even go for it will compare column proportions. Okay, so like this, your result come. Here, it is a cross tab is being shown first, then the chi-square result comes. And it shows that the p-value is less than 0.05. So there is some association between age group and that of attitude. So now what do you have to do? You have to look at the table and you have to check where this expected and observed is getting changed. Depending on that, you have to take inference from this table. Okay. Now, one more thing I have assured to tell you was correlation and regression. So, suppose you want to examine the relationship between two sets of data, you go for finding out the correlation if it is a continuous data. And you know that there are, so this is a data, examine the relationship between hen weight and feed intake. So what you want to do, you know that you have correlation coefficient, Calpius and correlation coefficient. It gives you a measure of degree of linear relationship. The data is ordinal. You might be going for Spearman's rank correlation coefficient. And if the correlation coefficient is significant, you may try to establish this relationship with a regression. So you will have you will have an independent variable and a dependent variable. And you have a regression equation. I know that I'm running short of time. So supposing that all these things you know, I'm just showing you how to do analysis, find correlation and regression in SPSS. So first we have to know that we have given weight cases. So I have to do not weight cases, okay. So now I have to check the data where the data. So this is the data I'm mentioning high hen weight and feed intake. Now analyze. First I want to check correlation. So correlate by variate. Now hen weight and feed intake. I want to check Pearson correlation only, then click OK. If I need a Spearman, I can put a tick mark over there. So here I can see that there is highly significant correlation. The value is 0.941 and the value is obtained as significant is taken as 0.00. It means that it is less than 0.001. So there is significant, the correlation is significant. So now I can go for regression, analyze regression. I want to fit a linear model only because it's a measure of degree of linear relationship. Correlation is significant and high. So feed intake, which is the response variable, hen weight. Hen weight depends on feed intake. Feed intake is the dependent variable. Now I can go for whatever you need, you can select from this options. I'm not going to do anything over there now. I just click OK. I get a result. This is giving you their R squared. That is, feed intake is able to explain 88% of variation in hen weight. And this is the R value, the same, the correlation coefficient value. So whether the model is a good fit, that is checked by ANOVA. Yes, model is a good fit. So here you can see the values, constant value and feed intake. So you can take it's whether it is significant or there by looking over here. And the equation for this is what is hen weight equal to minus 0.597 plus 0.067 into feed intake, like that. So there is 0.067 change is happening in hen weight due to the one unit change in feed intake. That's what regression tell you. Okay, now you have to learn more in SPSS. What you have to do is, whatever, if you have installed SPSS in your computer, you just click here, there is help. Okay, when you click help, whether you are offline or online, whatever it may be, other window opens and it is this one. And in this one, you can see in the left pane something known as, here it comes like this, case studies. In case studies, you click on the which test you want to study, whatever it may be, you can click. So you can see one sample t-test. Then it tells you what is one sample t-test. Next, with an example in your computer in which you have installed SPSS, it comes with a lot of sample files. From the sample files, they will be using one of the file. So you can take the sample file and do the analysis and check how it, all the results it will show and how to do the analysis. All these are within SPSS itself. If you have software in your system, you can do this and click on next. They will give you how to do the analysis and what output will be shown for that particular data and how to interpret those observations. Everything is there. Okay, so if you want to study SPSS and if you have a system with SPSS, it is very easy for them, easy for you. You have to, you can do it. Okay, everything is there in the software itself. It helps you. Now, only the thing I haven't told you is how to save it. Just click on save. If you have output window you want to save, click on save. Then the window comes up. You have to give the file name and the destination where it is to be saved and click save, then it will be saved. And another thing is that you have to export the output, whatever you, because your computer may not be having SPSS, you might be having only Excel or Word in your computer. So you have to click on file, export. Another window gets opened and the whatever be the format you need, Word or Excel, whatever the format you need, you can select it over here. And from this browse, you can select the path where you want to save the file. Then click OK. It will be saved in the format you have specified. This is how you save the results of your work. Okay, so that's all about the statistical computing using SPSS. I know sometimes it might be a bit faster because there were a lot of things to cover and the time was only 1.5 hours, and I used to take for 2 hours or 2 days. We used to cover all these things because you need to have a hands-on training. But in your department, you have those facilities. So I have given you an introduction. So if you are interested to learn any software, the thing is that you have to get an introduction, how to open, how to think, how to do some or other things. Then you will be learned by yourself. You have to learn by yourself. Enough. If you search in Google, you have enough videos, and even SPSS and all, there are, I have told you how to use help for studying it. So it is very easy. Only the thing is that you should have an attitude and a desire to do that, desire to study that. Okay, thank you. Thank you for your patient listening, and thank you all. Any questions or anything?
Dear participants, if you have any doubts or if you want any clarification, please ask now. Madam, I
yes,
have
sir.
Yes, regarding the selection of
yes.
test, like suppose we want to compare several population.
Okay.
You have mentioned ANOVA and
Kirwalis
test, right? So how we distinguish or how we
select? ANOVA comes with certain assumptions like that. You have to have it should be following normal distribution. You can check it with Shapiro-Wilk test whether the data follows a normal distribution for each different group also. And also if it is following normal distribution, then only we are permitted to use it. And one thing is that you can go for transformation of data like log transformation, sine arc transformation, square root transformation, like that. Again, you can check whether it is following normal distribution. If it is following normal distribution, you can use ANOVA. It's okay. And you have to check also whether the variances are, variance of the groups are same or not, and whether the addictive model assumption is satisfied or not. So these are the three assumptions of ANOVA. You have to check it. If it is okay, you can proceed with ANOVA. If something is getting violated, and if you are not, then you are not permitted to use ANOVA, isn't it? So in that case, what you have to do? You have to go for Kruskal values ANOVA. Okay, that is the non-parametric counterpart, because we are not allowed to use a particular test if the data violates the assumptions of that particular test. So it happens when we do analysis over here. It happens when the variances are assumption is not followed. Again, there are some you can see the below. There are some tests for post-hoc comparison. They say that variances are not same. Then also ANOVA is robust. But if it is not following normal distribution, if it is an ordinal data, we are not permitted to use it for use the usual ANOVA. We are only permitted to use if the data is ordinal, and if not, interval ratio, and we get that it is not following normal distribution, then we are not allowed to use ANOVA. We are permitted to use only Kruskal values one way ANOVA. Okay, that's all.
So that means there are several restrictions to use the
ANOVA. Three assumptions of ANOVA is there now. You have to check it.
I think someone case test is used for confirming this data is normal.
Gross-Murnau test can be used, and other than that, there is Shapiro-Wilk test also is there. So when you do it in SPSS, you can see that we have gone to analyze descriptive statistics, explore, and we have checked a column box named normality with plots. So from there you can get whether the data follows normal distribution or not. Okay.
I feel useful for the researchers and the students because many of the students are in time of their projects. They are starting they have started their projects, and most of them are trying to understand SPSS and R. So in this time you have given one.
Thank you, sir. I think that, but when we give a lot of things at once, they may be feeling difficult to grasp it. Okay, so I never give this much things in a short span of time. We used to give it as a hands-on training only. Which is how you do something.
No problem, madam. They have seen what are the things.
Yes,
they
this is an introduction, and if they are if they really want to do, they can check it. Develop the skill. Okay. Thank you, sir.
Okay, thank you so much, ma'am. That was quite informative talk. It seems like no doubts. Moving on, we come to close our program. I invite RV CR, student of final year MSc Statistics, for giving vote of thanks.
Good afternoon to one and all. On this wonderful occasion, I would like to present the vote of thanks. I take this golden opportunity to thank our respected principal, St. Thomas College, Autonomous Thrissur, Reverend Father Martin K.A. for inaugurating the webinar and for being with us even in this busy schedule. Thank you, Father. Next, I would like to express my sincere gratitude to the chief speaker of the day, Reza Vier, Assistant Professor, Department of Statistics, College of Veterinary and Animal Science, Manupur, who spared precious time from her busy schedule to impart valuable and informative lessons on SPSS, which will be definitely very helpful in our future. Thank you. Now I extend my gratitude to our respected head of the Department of Statistics, Dr. V.M. Chako, for the presidential address, and thank you, sir, for your encouragement and support throughout this program. Next, I would like to thank Ms. Ashley Matthew PM, Assistant Professor, Department of Statistics, St. Thomas College, Thrissur, the coordinator of the program, and welcoming all of us to the webinar. Thank you, ma'am. Last but not least, my deep sense of appreciation and thanks to all the participants who chose to live with us and attend the webinar with great enthusiasm and made it a successful event. Once again, I thank you all for being with us. Thank you.
Thank you, thank you.
Thank you, Arati. Here we come to end of our dinner. A good event never ends in the world. They just take only a pause and keep us awaiting for the next. It was our privilege to have you all online with us today. Once again, thank you all for your presence. Thank you.
Thank you, thank you. Please mark your attendance in the chat box.
Okay, sir. I'll leave it. Thank you, sir. Thanks a lot. Thank you,
madam. Okay.
Thank you, Anusri. And thank you all.
Thank you, miss.
അപ്പൊ എന്തായാലും വലിയ ഒരു നന്ദി കുട്ടി അല്ല കുട്ടികൾക്ക് കേറാൻ പറ്റാതെ 100 കഴിഞ്ഞിട്ടേ ഞാൻ പിന്നെ അവസാനം രണ്ടാമത് ലിങ്ക് ഇട്ട് കൊടുത്തു എല്ലാരും അതന്നെ തന്നെ പല ഗ്രൂപ്പുകളിൽ കയറിയുണ്ട് അപ്പോ എന്തായാലും എല്ലാവർക്കും യൂസ്ഫുൾ ആണ് എസ് പി എസ് എസ് കാണുമ്പോൾ എല്ലാവരും മിക്കവാറും എല്ലാവരും ഉപയോഗിക്കുന്നത് അത് തന്നെയാണ്. ഇന്നൊരു ക്ലാസ് ഇല്ലാത്തോണ്ടോ ഞങ്ങൾക്കൊന്നും ക്ലാസ് ഇല്ല, അതാണ്. നമുക്കൊന്നും ക്ലാസ് ഇല്ല. നിങ്ങളുടെ അവിടെ ക്ലാസ് ഉണ്ടോ? ക്ലാസ് നടക്കുന്നുണ്ടോ? അത് ശരി. ആ ആ അല്ല, കുട്ടികൾ വരുമെന്ന്. ആയിക്കോട്ടെ. അതെ അതെ അതെ. അല്ല, അതുകൊണ്ട് നമുക്ക് യൂസ്ഫുൾ ആയിരിക്കും. മറ്റേതെല്ലാവരും വരില്ല, മറ്റേതാകുമ്പോഴേ കുറച്ച് കുട്ടികൾ ഉണ്ടാവും. അതെ. അല്ല, അത് മെജോറിറ്റി നമ്മുടെ കുട്ടികളാണ്. പിന്നെ വിമല എന്നുള്ളവരുണ്ടാവും, റൈസി എന്നുള്ളവരുണ്ടാവും. കുറച്ച് പേര് ജെൻസൺ സാറും കയറി ഉണ്ടായിരുന്നു. ജെൻസൺ സാറൊക്കെ കയറി ഉണ്ടായിരുന്നു. പിന്നെ ഡിമാറ്റ്, അങ്ങനെ കുറച്ച് പേര് പുറത്തുനിന്ന് കയറി ഉണ്ടായിരുന്നു ടീച്ചേഴ്സ്. അത് ശരി. അങ്ങനെ അതെ 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 അതെ. പിന്നെ ടീച്ചറെ, ഗൂഗിൾ പേ ഉണ്ടല്ലോ അല്ലേ ടീച്ചറിൻ്റെ കയ്യില്? ഗൂഗിൾ പേ ഉണ്ടോ ടീച്ചറിൻ്റെ കയ്യില്? എനിക്ക് അത് സാറല്ല, ഞങ്ങൾ ചെറിയൊരു ഇത് സന്തോഷം. ആ ശരി, ആയിക്കോട്ടെ 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 ആയിക്കോട്ടെ. അപ്പോൾ ടീച്ചർ എനിക്കൊന്ന് തന്നു അങ്ങനെയാണെ കൊണ്ടേ ഞങ്ങളുടെ ഒന്ന്. അല്ല, അക്കൗണ്ട് നമ്പർ എൻ്റെ ഉണ്ടോ?